Okay.
This is an interview at the New York State Military Museum, Saratoga Springs, New York. This is the 28th of April, 2005, approximately 10:30 a.m. Interviewers are Wayne Clark and Mike Russert. Could you give me your full name, date of birth, and place of birth, please?
Jim Davis Nelson, and my date of birth is December 21st, 1943, at Beloit, Kansas.
Okay, what was your educational background prior to entering service?
I went to, my father was professor at the University of Colorado in philosophy, and so therefore I went to high school in Boulder, Colorado, and then when I graduated from high school, I went to New York City by myself, got on a train in Kansas, and went to New York City to try to attend a trade school. I figured I needed a trade, and my avocation at that time was, and my hopes were, to become a painter of paintings. I never wanted to become a quote-unquote an artiste or an artist, because everybody was an artist, you know, even basketball players were artists. So I just wanted to be a painter of pictures, and I wanted to study with the best I could. And I tried to apply for the Slade School, London, England. I got rejected from that school, and I ended up in New York City studying at the Art Students League and the National Academy, and I ended up with scholarships at the Art Students League. I had a Ford Foundation scholarship that paid for my supplies and some of the cost of my classes. I believe two of my classes were paid for by that Ford scholarship, and that was in 1962 to 1967. And during that time, I had gainful employment at with an industrial design firm named Raymond Lloyd Williams Snaith, who was one of the most famous architectural industrial designers in the world. Raymond Lloyd designed the streamline locomotives for the Pennsylvania Railroad. He also designed the 64 Avanti Studebaker, the Studebaker 52 Studebaker. Did work with Cadillac, designed the Coca-Cola bottle, designed the interior Cunard shipping lines, also did the, even President Kennedy's Air Force One, did the color scheme and the interior decor of the airplane. Mm. And so I was very fortunate to get a very high paying job, and finally ended up with a studio on Fifth Avenue right across from the Metropolitan Museum at 1008 Fifth Avenue. And I did portraits there, and I also did murals in my large living room, did the sketches, and then I would be sent to different stores, May Company stores out of Chicago, May D&F, famous bar stores in different cities to do murals, mainly Western murals, because mm-hmm. I was good at horses also. Mm-hmm. So my whole career was changed when I was, I got a letter from President Johnson, greetings from the President of the United States, you are now inducted, conscripted into the United States Army.
What year was that?
That was April 1960, actually February of 1967, and I still had a scholarship that I was attending classes, and I was able to postpone my induction 30 days to transfer back to Denver, Colorado, where I wanted to serve with fellows from my own part of the country. I wanted to serve with what I was hoping was fellow Kansans, but I ended up with down at Fort Bliss, Texas, in basic training April 7th of 1967. I was inducted in Denver and then flown down to Texas and then started. It was a very rigorous wartime infantry training, very brutal training. We had, out of 120 soldiers in our training company, only 60 of us made it physically and mentally through the first 9 weeks of training, mm-hmm. or 8 weeks, I forget. The rest had physical and nervous breakdowns. We had 3 attempted suicides. We had, it was very, very Marine Corps-like training. They were preparing us for the worst in a wartime scenario.
But, you were there for 9 weeks, you said?
Right, and then I was then, I made it through basic training, and then I went to advanced infantry training at Fort Polk, Louisiana, which was supposed to have been more severe training, but it actually turned out to be a rather pleasant experience. We had some long marches, but basically the tone of treatment to the soldiers were, which was more less aggressive, a little more considerate. We had no time off except on Sunday mornings, and that's when I did a few sketches. I started doing a few sketches at that time, and one of my sketches is going to be with the new show I'm having here at the New York State Military Museum, April 29th of this year. We are having a reception, and of course about 30 of my paintings are on display with Dave DeMarro's combat photographs from a sister battalion. So I started doing watercolor sketches at Fort Polk, I also did pretty good on some of the tests, and I got a 3-day pass to Alexandria, Virginia, where I was able to sleep for 2 of the 3 days. I'll never forget that.
Now, how long was your advanced training at Fort Polk?
That was about 9 weeks also, 8 or 9 weeks.
In retrospect, how do you think the training you received prepared you for Vietnam?
Well, the training at Fort Bliss was supposed to have been what was called a spirit de corps, which meant to motivate the soldiers, that is, to break down the soldier mentally, to condition them and recondition them mentally for infantry training. But what I thought really happened under the conditions I saw myself was that it really had a negative effect. I think it took a lot of the adventurism and the spirit of patriotism out of some of the soldiers because of the brutality that we went through. I mean, when you had people literally fall over, keel over from total exhaustion, and they're not taking care of those people. Those people end up in the hospital, possibly with severe injuries. I thought that was probably not for the best regarding the spirit of which they were trying to create. I thought Fort Polk had a lot better viewpoint, and they had a better training. I think their training was more hands-on. We went out to rifle ranges more. We handled different types of weapons, even World War II bazookas. That was the most fun weapon to fire, was a bazooka.
Now, did you get orders for Vietnam right out of AIT?
No. When you went to Fort Polk, you knew you were going to Vietnam. The orders were after basic training. When you headed to North Fort at Fort Polk, and that was about 13 miles north of the main fort, you knew where you were going. There was no ifs and buts, no doubts in everybody's minds, and there were thousands of troops marching, and cadences were everywhere. All the old World War II barracks were where our forefathers had lived during World War II in Korea, and there was sort of a feeling of an unsaid feeling of understanding that this was where your forefathers, my father, as a matter of fact, was at Fort Polk 25 years to the day I was at Fort Polk in training to be a forward observer in World War II. And he was probably maybe accommodated in the same barracks as or the same avenue of barracks as where I was accommodated. There were about 60 soldiers to a barracks, a very small shower area, and bathroom at the end of the barracks, wooden floors, two stories, bed bunks, head to toe and toe to head type arrangement, and they were bunk beds also. So there were about 60 soldiers per barracks, and those barracks were had no air conditioning, and so we it was 105 degrees when I was there in June and July, and it was extremely hot, but I'd been quite used to the warm weather coming from the Midwest, so it didn't bother me like some others.
Mm-hmm. How did everybody get along?
Most people really got along quite well. There was a lot of, you met a lot of more people. There was a little more friendship among the ranks. You could get familiar with people because you weren't in a life and death scenario like in Vietnam. Sometimes you didn't want to get too familiar with friends because they may not survive. And there was, I believe, something said about the fact that the human mind sort of protects itself maybe by not getting too familiar with fellow soldiers in a combat situation, because some of you know as well as your buddy that one of you may not survive. Of course, the idea was to have a buddy, and that happened quite often because one buddy was responsible for the other, and so many times a buddy that you befriended in the front lines would be in a position to save your life. And so that was called the buddy system, and I painted a painting called the buddy system. And it's in the, it's not here, it's actually owned by a gentleman in Massachusetts, but it's a good painting. It shows a rifleman shooting his M16 over his wounded friend. Mm-hmm. And it was a good title for a painting. So a lot of my paintings are derived from actual experience.
Mm-hmm. After you left Polk, where did you go?
Polk, I had a 30-day leave, and I went back to New York City to visit old friends, say goodbye, and I really didn't believe I was coming back. From what I'd learned at Polk from sergeants that had just come back, buck sergeants that had just come back to Fort Polk and taken us out on patrols, and they told us what the real story was over there. It was a pretty bad situation as far as life expectancy. Your life expectancy wasn't more than 2 weeks on point, and if you were in a bad human wave attack, it was really it was a situation. Also, who was your company commander? You could luck out and have a good company commander. You could probably luck out and be in a bad unit, and dependent on who you were with, what your chances were. One other thing that we were told was the M16s were jamming, and I'll never forget being told to get hold of a snub-nosed revolver and get it over there through the shakedowns, and I did that. I bought a snub-nosed Smith & Wesson. Actually, I couldn't afford a Smith & Wesson. I bought an Italian copy, and I hid it in the blouse of my boot, and of course I had the 38 ammo in my duffel bag, but they were very sensitive about having any non-military issued weapons coming in country. But I taped a Smith & Wesson's into the blouse of my boots for 5 days. I had that revolver taped in my leg, blouser of my boot, right above my boot. I didn't take my boots or pants off for 5 days. From the time we left Oakland, California, to the time I arrived at my destination up near the Cambodian border at Dao Tang, Vietnam, with the 3rd Brigade of the 25th Division. So by that time my leg was starting to swell, but at least I got my revolver there, and I had a shoulder holster too. And that was a good advice from the buck sergeant at Fort Polk, because the M16 was jamming.
Mm-hmm. Did that revolver ever save your life, do you think?
Came close. I fortunately did not want to use it. I had, when I was on LP, there were several times when in the rain, I could hear the enemy walk by me. But the best plan under those circumstances was not to give away your position, but to stay behind that log and lie on the ground with maybe your other two friends and not make a noise. Your mission on LP was to report the enemy movement toward the perimeter. And I have a painting in my show called LP at Bert, and it actually tells a story in Jim Dice's own handwriting, that is in his own words, of what he went through at Bert. He was caught out in front of a fire support base during a human wave attack on January 1st, 1968. That was the worst scenario you could imagine to be in, because you were expendable. You were not allowed to come back to the perimeter. Your job was only to announce the arrival of the enemy that was massing for an attack. And then you could hear them out in front of you, and they could find you, they would kill you, they would eliminate you in the radio. And you had this radio, and you had to give a situation report, which was called a sit-rat report, every hour on the hour. And we passed the radio between ourselves, and two of us slept while the other stayed awake on guard. But sometimes that third person might go to sleep, so I didn't usually go to sleep. I usually kept awake all the time. That was the only time you were able to get sleep.
Mm-hmm. Now, who is Jim Dice?
Jim Dice is a fellow from a veteran from Dayton, Ohio, who is in my book. I wrote a book called Vietnam War Paintings, art by.
If you hold it up under your chin, Wayne can focus on it.
Yes, and it's narratives by participants, and in the book there's a painting showing Jim Dice and a narrative by him. Wish I could find it right here, I'm sure. But Jim Dice was very, very kind in contributing to my book, and he wrote a rather true to life narrative describing his situation at Fire Support Base Bird, and I was very grateful that he contributed, and this is the painting. It's a little painting, 11 by 8 inches. And that's Jim Dice with his two friends that were hiding behind the trees when Fire Support Base Burt was attacked. Yeah. I hope you can
get okay.
No, when you went to the 25th Division, you went in as a replacement unit.
Yes,
as
I did.
A replacement.
Just an individual replacement. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Were there any others that were trained with you that went into the same unit, or?
Yes, we all ended up with the 25th Division, but some of we were split up among different battalions.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them went to Wolfhound, some of them went to Manchu, some went to Golden Dragons. I went to Triple Deuce up at Dao Tang. Some went to other units. There were like 5 battalions per brigade, and I think 3 battalions were infantry. Of course, there was the armored mechanized unit too, the 3/4 cavalry, which was I think a little more. Those young men probably were more specialized in tanks and trained at Fort Campbell, Kentucky. We had armored personnel carriers, and you didn't have to go to tank school to drive an armored personnel carrier.
What were your first impressions when you arrived in Vietnam? Sights, smells, sounds?
Well, like anybody, the intense heat and the smell. Smell was the worst odor of soil, the bugs, the decaying bugs, when you first got off the plane, of course, it was the heat, and of course, even the smell was a pungent odor. When you got to the base camps, the air was permeated with the odor of burning human waste, because that's the way the waste was burnt in. And one of my paintings depicts that, and it shows Nick Dragon and Greg Hall burning waste at Dao Tang, and it's called Somebody's Got to Do It.
And whereabouts did you land in Vietnam? Cameron or Saigon?
I landed in Cameron Bay.
Okay.
And then I was supposed to go to Pleiku, 4th Division, but at the last moment they changed my orders to 25th Division.
Okay.
And when we got to Coochie, we went to a replacement center for a few days, and the general that welcomed us said our division had the lowest casualty rates of all the division. But I noticed in the historical records that the 25th Division had the second highest casualties of any division after the war was concluded and casualties were figured out.
When did you first experience combat, and what were your feelings?
That would have been in September of 67 when I arrived at my destination at Dao Tang. Of course, we'd had some mortar attacks at Coochie, and we ran to the bunkers while we were there at the replacement center.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't consider that combat. I think combat would have really been your first experience in a firefight. And that was out in the Michelin rubber plantations, which were ominous rows of trees that went on for miles and miles. And each tree had tunnels, a tunnel effect. And it was totally like dark, even during midday. It was dark with water dripping off the leaves. And at night, huge spider webs hung between these trees. And these big spiders that must have had diameter-wise of 3 to 2 feet, 2 to 3 feet, were hanging in these webs in the moonlight. And not one person I knew was bit by this spider. There was a very, very scary thing to walk into a web like mm-hmm. that at night. I still suffer from arachnophobia mm-hmm. to this day. I was scared of black widows before then, yes, but nothing like what we saw in Vietnam hanging between those trees at night. Of course, during pitch black, you know, you would walk into these webs, and you knew the spider was somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
But not one person was bit by it. These were probably very timid spiders. I really don't know the name of them or anything, but they weren't like a tarantula, but mm-hmm. their bodies were thinner, but their legs were longer.
Mm-hmm.
But they made very big webs between those Michelin trees. And of course, when we were in the first firefight, we were in a kind of a running battle with the enemy in those trees. And the enemy had a little spider hole, and they had tried to ambush our armored personnel carriers as we were moving up one of the roads through the Michelin. And of course, we counterattacked it, and they killed those Viet Cong or NVA in those spider holes. And there were grenades being lobbed in the hole, and the enemy would lob the grenade back out.
Mm-hmm.
Another grenade was lobbed in, and the enemy in desperation would lob the grenade out. It would explode among our soldiers. Finally, we got wise. We counted a few seconds before the third grenade was thrown in. Of course, I was on the ground watching this, protecting a flank. My platoon sergeant told me, I and Jerry Russo, we had to lie at this angle to protect the flank. So actually, that was the first firefight I was in.
Mm-hmm.
And they finally killed the enemy, or enemies in those holes. But they were in spider holes. And I believe they were probably in position to cover retreat of their unit. That's what they often did. They would put up resistance so that the rest of them could escape.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever encounter any booby traps?
Oh, yes. A lot of Chi-Com anti-personnel mines that were exploded in the trees around us, and the shrapnel being, you know, disseminated through the Michelin River plantation,
mm-hmm.
and the whiz and the hiss of the fragments passing by your head, and or ricocheting off the side of the track. We were always outside the track. We always provided flank security for the tracks. We very seldom rode the tracks because our platoon sergeant wanted those tracks protected from rocket-propelled grenades. So we were always off to the flank to a good 20 to 30 feet walking among the trees. So unless we were moving in hot pursuit or to try to come to the aid of a sister battalion or another company, did we mount up on the tracks and ride on the tracks. Mainly we walked and provided flank security. It was a different modus of operandi because most of the scenes you'll see in historical films and videos of mech units, everybody's riding on top of the tracks, but our unit was different. Our platoon sergeant made us walk, and we were to protect those tracks from rocket propelled grenades, and that was a lot of extra work. Plus we dug in a lot thorough, and we had concertina wire. The enemy was watching you. They always watched the units that dug in. They didn't attack the dug-in units as much as the ones that were ill-prepared.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned in the form you filled out that your company was very aggressive in the field. What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean that we were always on point. We were always, it seemed like, even our platoon, my sergeant, Sergeant K, who was a Korean War veteran, he was more experienced than our company commander when I arrived. Our company commander, who later became extremely knowledgeable, was smart enough to listen to an E6 platoon sergeant, mm-hmm. and know the ropes, learn the ropes of daily conduct and daily plan of movement. So I was fortunate to have a very aggressive platoon sergeant who was always volunteering our company or our platoon for unending missions. And we hardly ever got any sleep. And it seemed to me like it was unending digging in. But you see, the enemy always was watching who was preparing their defenses. They did not want to attack those elements as much as they wanted to attack a unit that was ill-prepared, that had not dug in. So we really were involved in a lot of pushing jungle, which was meant we drove the tracks through the jungle. We didn't stay on the roads. We didn't stay on the trails. We stayed out in the jungle or in the Michelin. We didn't push over Michelin rubber trees because we were fined by the French Michelin Rubber Company, $50 for every tree we injured. Our government had to pay that damage, and then the Michelin Company would pay taxes to the Viet Cong with that money that they got from our government. But basically, when we were in the jungle, Iron Triangle, we went right through the jungle and pushed trees over with the tracks. And that way the enemy wasn't able to form a defensive perimeter or ambush us easily. When we did, our mission was to try to find enemy base camps and then assault those base camps and overrun them, do away with those enemy base camps. And that's what I meant by being aggressive, because we did run into a lot of enemy base camps.
How did you feel about, obviously, the knocking over the rubber trees was kind of a rule of engagement? How did you feel about those rules of engagement?
Well, we didn't knock over the rubber trees.
Well, you weren't allowed to.
We weren't allowed to.
So that was kind of a rule of engagement. How did you feel about rules of engagement?
Well, I didn't believe in no fire zones at all. There were areas where we had to be in that. We had to, evidently, brigade headquarters had to get permission from the village chief or the provincial chief to return fire, and that was absolutely insane. I mean, to be in the I later, when I was brigade draftsman, I heard desperate calls from some of our units that had been ambushed, and they weren't our artillery from Camp Rainier, Dao Tang, was not allowed to fire to help cover their defense, because you depended on your friendly fire to defend from being attacked in many cases. And there were times when attacks occurred out in certain areas, certain districts, which the provincial chief had to be contacted for some strange reason to before we were able to provide friendly fire to help our own soldiers. I thought that was insane. Of course, that was a decision made at MACV headquarters, I presume. I know it wasn't by our captain or by our fine brigade colonel or our battalion commander, lieutenant colonel. These decisions, I think, were micromanaged out by President Johnson, and from what I understand, Johnson controlled, micromanaged all air attacks, and McLemore micromanaged all infantry and Army and Marine actions. So everything was being decided in Washington instead of by people who were there.
In retrospect, I don't know if you read McNamara's books or anything. How did you feel about him?
Well, McNamara was one of Kennedy's whiz kids,
the best and the brightest.
Right, and they were Ivy League know-it-alls with very little practical experience. He'd had some experience at Ford Motor Company before he became Secretary of Defense, but I think he was a very naive person. He needed to be on point for 2 weeks with one of our units. Then I think he would have understood. Anybody that questions the bravery and courage of the American soldier in Vietnam needed to be on point for 2 weeks. And then they would, I believe, have a more better understanding of what it really was like.
Mm-hmm. Were you ever wounded?
I had shrapnel wounds to my face, and that was something that was insignificant in my mind, because at those times I had friends that were killed and mm-hmm. wounded very severely, so I felt very fortunate.
Did you receive a Purple Heart? Or?
No, I would not. I wouldn't think a Purple Heart would be appropriate because of the insignificance of it.
Mm-hmm. How about the food? How did you feel about your food and your equipment?
Well, the food was, we had one hot meal a day brought in by Chinook helicopter, mule skinners, and I remember that was gobbled down on a paper plate that was soaked with rain, and if you were lucky to eat it before you were out on ambush patrol, you were a very lucky fellow. Actually, you were eating fast and digging fast at the same time, because you didn't have time left before you had to go on LP or ambush patrol. Mm-hmm. And that was what I was talking about before, the aggressiveness of it. We had no time off. There was no time to visit other soldiers at other armored personnel carriers. Every armored personnel carrier was sort of a world to itself. And then, of course, as an individual, you had tunnel vision yourself. So you were in the jungle, you were able only to see 5 feet this way and 6 feet that way and 8 feet ahead. And it was really a different experience. A worm's eye view was really a worm's eye view. And the food was good, but most of the time we didn't have breakfast. We ate sea rations when we were out on perimeter guard. When the unit stopped, we'd stop on flank security. When we moved, sometimes we moved 11 clicks a day through the jungle or down these areas. That would have been equivalent to about 7 miles a day. Other days we moved less, but it was an exhausting experience to go through the Tri-Canopy jungle with the thorns, and lots of times you were on your hands and knees also, crawling under the bush.
What was worse for you, the heat or the rain?
The rain was a godsend. Mm-hmm. The rain was, because I was there during the monsoon. I was in the infantry during the monsoon. Then I was picked brigade draftsman. The rain was always cool or cold at night, and it washed your clothing. You know, if you were lying in buffalo dun all night long on ambush patrol like I did one night, and mosquitoes were all around you, and you wore a net around your helmet, tucked down in your collar, and then you would have a beautiful cloudburst the next morning that would wash your clothes out from all this putrid smell from buffalo dun or something else. The jungle stunk, like I told you. I mean, you have no idea. It was bugs decaying, foliage decaying. I never smelled plants that were so revolting. I mean, you could touch a fern. There was a certain fern that you touch and it move away from you. It had almost a human quality. It's a weird world. And of course, in my book, I talk about the night Jim Frost, my squad leader, it was so dark, our ambush patrol was, we were in such darkness that we had to hold on each other's web gear, tripping and falling down and standing up again, trying to move through this dense jungle. And you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And we came to a small clearing. And I remember at our last reunion, I talked to Jim Frost about this, and he remembered it. I did not remember it, but he remembered it, that we saw something glowing on the ground. And I know this sounds crazy, but it was some sort of vegetation that had a glow to it. And we picked these leaves off this vegetation, I believe, and we put them in the elastic band in the back of our helmets, and we were able to see each other's back of his helmet for about 5 minutes till we got to our destination. Well, that only happened one time, and then I was reading the book that Mrs. Burnham, the missionary in the Philippines, had wrote recently. Her husband was captured by Filipino guerrillas, and she and her husband were captured. They were missionaries over there, and she talks about the plants that were glowing in that book. So I looked up on a Google search, went to a website, and sure enough, there is what's called bio-glowing plants, which are evidently synonymous to the tropics. And then you have a phosphorus-type element that it's sort of a glow that occurs. So actually, I saw one of those plants. It was very unique.
Did you have any contacts with the Vietnamese people?
Yes, we moved villages out into... we tried to get some of the friendly villagers to move out of their villages. A lot of them cooperated. They would move, including pigs and so forth. They would move villages to safer areas, areas down, probably down by Saigon. They loaded them onto helicopters. Because we were in a war zone there, it was a pretty bad area as far as the enemy assassinating certain villagers, mayors, certain political types, I believe. I think there were 467 political assassinations by the Viet Cong in our area in 1968. And those villagers were probably friendlies, and sometimes we moved those people out. Other times, we were out in the jungle for 45 days at a time, and if we saw anybody, it was it may be these whores that were on motorcycles with their pimps that would try to come up to us to entice some of the soldiers. But sometimes in the villages we went through, there would be young children that would be selling coke, but we knew that some coke bottles had battery acid in them, and but we lived next door to brigade headquarters was next to Dao Tang, and civilians worked inside the base camp, and you got to see a lot of the young women and the Mamazons that worked to clean up the barracks and so forth, but I remember the night that a lot of them were assassinated by the Viet Cong in that village, and I was on perimeter duty that night and saw the bullets ricocheting into the sky. Next morning, a lot of the Vietnamese women, a lot of them were expecting children, and children also were killed in that village by the enemy. And that was never reported by the American press.
Now, were worth most of your actions against the VC or the NVA?
Yes. After the Tet Offensive, there was no VC left, mm-hmm. really.
Right.
So everything else then became NVA. Mm-hmm. But there was a lot of NVA. In the Battle of Trapezoids, 5 miles south of Dao Tang, which I depict in some of my paintings, that was an NVA base camp. It was the 101st NVA Division, and they were one of the major base camps. The base camp was so big, we did not find all the underground tunnels and all the underground grenade factories and everything they had there. It was so immense. It was probably one of the largest underground base camps that was in existence.
What were relationships like within your unit?
Well, that depended on the person, I believe. If you felt you had to get along with people to survive. Mm-hmm. But there was situations that I remember that were really not good, and I had a lot of experience in New York City, and so I knew probably a little more about that subject than a lot of the farm kids and the middle class kids that came from mid-America or the small town America, whether it be on the East Coast or whether it be in the Midwest or the West. And so I tried to avoid conflict. In one of my paintings, I show a staff sergeant eating the contents of a gift package that was meant for one of the privates, and he would then, according to my friend who was in the 2nd of the 77th Artillery, he would then take the empty can and give it to him and ask him if he was upset that his mother wasn't there with him, you see. Now that was a racial motivated action there. But if you had a superior that was of that attitude, you were in a world of hurt. You would be in misery. And that could happen so easy. And I tried to get along with everybody, and I tried to become friends with everybody. But at the same time, if there were a number of us that knew just by intuition, I would say, that some people could be trusted more than others. Mm-hmm. And I always got along with the fellows from the rural America, and I wanted to be around those Southerners because they hunted squirrels, and they were absolutely incredible at marksmen. So I was very comfortable with those fellows more than I would be with somebody from the city, because they had actually experienced hunting, mm-hmm. and had a lot of experience with with target practice. And and it was an inspiration to be with those people. I made a lot of friends over there. Some did not survive. And I show some of those people in my paintings.
You kind of alluded to this off camera and a little while ago. What are your feelings about the media coverage of the war?
Well, I think it was basically borders on treason and is totally unexcusable. These 70-some percent of the young American soldiers volunteered for Vietnam. They answered the call and the tradition of their forefathers. And then to be character assassinated, like the media did during the war and especially after they came home, was an absolute abomination. I know that if that had happened during World War I, there would have been public outrage. Yeah, during World War II, there would have been people hauled off to the courts and tried for anti-sedition laws. You had people like Jane Fonda that got away with it.
And what are your feelings about her now with her new book and so on?
Well, she's I consider her a traitor, and she caused a lot of American soldiers to get killed and wounded by encouraging the enemy. And I know from that a fact because I was there. And the enemy's morale was encouraged by those who demonstrated against the American soldier in Vietnam. And I believe that any American soldier should be supported by the public. Maybe they have a right to their opinion on the validity of interventionism and internationalism, which has put us in a lot of wars. But to turn against your own people in harm's way, that is treasonous, and they should be prosecuted. Or they should pay retributions to the families of the POWs and MIAs that suffered so bad after their sons and daughters did not come home. That would be, in my mind, a fair solution to that. They pay, like I said.
How do you feel about America's involvement in retrospect? Do you think we should have been there?
Well, we were in a Cold War scenario, and there was a lot of CETO looking back at it, like being an armchair historian and a layman, I would say that There are questions how we got there in the first place. It goes back way before Kennedy, but I remember when I was in New York, I was watching the failed invasion of Cuba, and I had a feeling that, and this is only my own opinion, that Kennedy was, well, when Kennedy was interviewed by Schlesinger, his biographer, he was asked, why are we involved in Vietnam? And Kennedy answered, because when you take one drink, you want another drink, which is a very strange answer, considering the consequences and the expenses and, of course, the committing of American soldiers into a foreign engagement. I had lunch with Marshall Key. Me and my wife about 5 years ago, had lunch with Marshall Key at Northern Colorado College at Greeley, Colorado. And I asked Marshall Key, I said, what was your opinion of the press in saying that it was a revolution? He said, no, he said it was an invasion of the North to the South, that it wasn't a revolution in the South, that it was actually an invasion of the North into the South. And I agree with that concept. And so, therefore, if we are in the present day effort to try to expand democracy in the Middle East, why is it that Vietnam was so different than that? I think it was really sad that we could have won the war, and we did win the war, I believe, in 1968, and yet I think the media lost it for us. But I believe in 1968, and I also have read accounts this many years afterwards that the North Vietnamese were just ready to capitulate when the U.S. Congress denied aid to the South Vietnamese Army. And during the Eastertide Offensive, the South Vietnamese Army conducted themselves very courageously and defeated the enemy. And then when the aid was relinquished, that's when they were overrun.
Mm-hmm. Now, when were you transferred in as a draftsman? You became a draftsman?
Right. Beginning of 68, right before the Tet Offensive. And I did all the main overlays during the Tet Offensive, and that was probably the most important drawing that I've ever done in my...
Now, what do you mean by overlays?
Well, you had grid coordinates on a large operation aerial or area of operations map. Mm-hmm. These were huge maps that were as large as this wall, 10 by 12 feet, in command bunkers. Every ambush patrol, every company, every unit had to be posted every day on those operation maps. The new counterinsurgency plans by Colonel Dames, who was working under Westmoreland, had to show the new areas of operations and the new areas where units, maybe hundreds and hundreds of infantrymen, were going to be dropped into jungle clearings. I had to draw all these on plastic sheets over the map with the correct grid coordinates, and those plastic sheets had to be transposed to other maps at other battalion headquarters. So if I misdrew those grid coordinates, then I would get probably American soldiers killed or wounded. So I think that was the most important part of drawing that I probably will ever have in my whole life, the responsibility of that.
Now, during this time in the service in Vietnam, did you do, I know earlier you said you did some watercolors. Were you able to do any other artwork at all? Or
captured my own watercolors in an enemy bunker. They were Japanese watercolors that the enemy used for propaganda purposes. When we went through enemy's villages, there would be some banners, maybe, in broken English, they were very humorously written, because their spelling was atrocious, almost as bad as my spelling. And their usage of American words were just pathetic. I mean, it would be so broken and so unimaginably confusing to read the banner what it really meant. It might say something like, Kong Dai Imperialism American Home or something, but they forgot the word go, you know. And so you would wonder, well, what is this? You know, is this an advertisement for some sort of tea, or is this a banner against American imperialism, you know? Mm-hmm. And well, anyway, I captured, when we overran the 101st enemy base camp, one of my buddies called me and said, Jim, there's a bunker here with, looks like watercolors. And so I went in there, and of course I felt around for a tripwire or anything like that, and I went in there, and there was a hole in the roof with a shaft of light coming in from the artillery that had come in before we finally made our final charge. And I mean, it was like 5 days of engagement. And here was a stack of watercolors. So I grabbed all of them and shoved them in my pockets, all my pockets I had. And I walked back, finally back, got back to our track, and I put them in the track, you know, with my ammo can, with my personal possessions. And those were watercolors that I used to do watercolors. You couldn't do many sketches. If I did, I carried the drawing pad under my flak jacket, but it got soaked. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't until I became brigade draftsman that I was able to resurrect some of my sketches and turn them into watercolors. And then I started. Then I sent for some oils. I had my parents send me some oil paints and brushes, and then I did a mural, big painting of the Battle of Burt. And General Gleason saw that painting and recommended me for the Division Combat Art Program. But I wasn't allowed to participate until I extended another 2 months. At the end of my tour duty, I extended to be, but I was allowed to do watercolors at night when I wasn't on guard duty, or oil paintings, and then I would take those down to Coochee and give them to 18th Military Historical Detachment. They included them into some of their books on combat art. They put out a book every 6 months, and those books were printed in Japan. Most of those watercolors have been stolen out of the division, 25th Division. Schofield Barracks Museum. I only have, about 5 years ago, I had 3 paintings in their museum, and I only have 1 painting now. Most of my paintings have disappeared.
I'm going back. How did you feel about Westmoreland?
Well, I saw him after Burt, and I did a map for him. I was as close from him to you. I didn't like him lecturing our company commander, saying it was the most shabbily dressed outfit he had seen, and they'd just been through 2 days of hell and had over 500 enemy body count lying on the ground in front of the tracks. I mean, we'd lost some of our people, and Tom Bernardi, the squad medic that I knew, was killed there, and I just didn't think it was appropriate that he characterize our company as the most shabbily dressed unit he had seen. I mean, most of these guys had been without sleep for a day and a half and were still covered with powder burns and of course, you know, the dirt of battle and everything like that.
Did you have any reaction to his relief when he was called back? Or?
No, I just didn't really know what General Abrams was going to do when he was replaced by General Abrams. General Abrams, I knew, had worked with Patton, so I was optimistic. But Westmoreland was a professional soldier, and of course he was picked by Johnson, I believe, and I think he miscalculated the numbers of enemies that were actually in our areas that were engaged against our soldiers. He had good his staff was very, Fred Whalen, General Whalen, was the general that perceived the Tet Offensive, and I think he probably was not given enough credit for his ability to anticipate the Tet Offensive.
So, when do you finally leave Vietnam?
I left Vietnam in November of 68 after my short career as combat artist at division headquarters, and I'd done over 40 paintings that the Army owned, and I was suffering from trench foot at the time, and I was in misery. When I got to Oakland, I got the early out and immediately was taken to the Naval hospital, and they took the hide, they put something on my my legs that took the hide right off my legs, and then I was put in a VA hospital for 3 weeks, and I was in excruciating pain. I never got over it until I saw a private physician at the Denver Skin Clinic, and they called in a doctor who had been in the South Pacific during World War II, and he knew exactly what bacterium it was. And that was the only way I got over it. Actually, I could have died from it because they told me there that it got in my bloodstream and I'd lost a lot of weight.
So, Chip, we're going to stop you here and I'll change tapes.
Fine. Well, I could.
Okay.
could say that.
All right, we're back.
Oh, okay, we're up.
You had some comments about General Westmoreland?
Well, I think that he couldn't relate to the common soldier in the field. I think he insulted Company C of the 22nd Infantry after the Battle of Bird, after they repulsed the main attack by the 9th Enemy Division, NVA Division, a horrific battle in which Company C of the 3rd of 22nd was overrun. And beehive rounds had to be fired, and yet the 2nd of the 22nd repulsed the main attack with their 50 calibers, and I think that that was uncalled for. And, you know, it didn't make a good impression on Captain Allison at all, and Captain Allison was a career Army officer, probably one of the best company commanders that I ever heard of.
And what was his full name?
Bill William Allison from Montgomery, Alabama, and he is comes to our battalion reunions, and he gives a second to none slide lecture. And if you ever have a chance to interview him, you would be doing yourself justice, because from a historical point of view, Captain, he retired colonel. But Allison gives one of the best slide lectures that you will ever hear in your life, and I would recommend him.
Mm-hmm. Okay, when were you finally discharged?
Like I said, in November, about 30th of pretty close to the 1st of December at Oakland Army Terminal there in 1968.
Did you join any veterans organizations at all?
Not for a few years. Fortunately, the VFW that I came, my hometown, Beloit, Kansas, VFW, welcomed me with open arms. And of course, I was instrumental in sending a telegram to Nixon to give pardon to Callie. And we had a unanimous, the VFW 6242 unanimously endorsed my motion, and they signed with 642 signatures a petition to Nixon and Senator Dole to, or Congressman Dole, I believe at that time, to pardon Callie.
Now, you have made reference to reunions. You've attended reunions?
Yes, sir. I recommend a reunion to every Vietnam veteran. They are the best thing that can happen to you when you meet your old buddies. Bygones are bygones. Everybody has a good time. You'd be surprised the number of successful veterans that we have that really the general public doesn't know about. Coy Thomas, who was in a sister sister platoon and second platoon, as shown in my book, he created the Jiffy Lube company. Basically, he started the whole idea of drive-through lubrication, and sold out to Shell Oil Company. And he's still a good friend of mine. Lives in Findlay, Illinois.
So did you stay in contact with any others prior to going to reunions?
No. I came back to the United States and decided to go to Europe and copy the paintings in Europe and the European countries. Ended up in Spain for about 6 months and came back to New York City on a tramp steamer loaded with cork and went through some terrific storms in the Atlantic on that little small transport vessel and got to New York and tried to pick up where I left off, but was treated so bad in New York as being a Vietnam veteran, I decided to leave and go back to my grandparents' farm back in Kansas, and that's where I ended up going. And then from there I struck out for Vancouver, British Columbia, did a lot of portrait work for Hudson Bay department stores, and I did a lot of portrait work in the States and a lot of Western painting, and basically stayed on the farm, and I met my wife about 14 years ago. I'd known her when I came back from Vietnam, but I procrastinated, and I was in debt. I'd bought farm ground, and I was doing some farming, and but doing a lot of painting, selling a lot of Western paintings. So I kept the brush smoking, you might say. Had to keep a fire extinguisher next to the easel.
How do you think your time in the service changed or had an effect on your life?
Well, I think it had a great effect on my life. I'm glad I went. I feel that the fellows I met in Vietnam were probably the best people I ever met in my whole life. Looking back in retrospect, especially, I didn't realize it until I went to one of their first reunions back in 1997. Down in Kissimmee, Florida. But I've done a lot of work for corporations, paintings for corporations, for law firms, for different private people, collections. I've met a lot of people since the war, and it didn't dawn on me, but until the first reunion I went to and met some of my old comrade in arms, that they were probably the best people that I've ever met in my life. And so we're just like brothers, and we get together every 18 months. And there's a reunion coming up at Kansas City, and I'm sort of on the committee.
Okay. Would you like to talk about some of your paintings?
That'd be fine.
Okay, we'll move outside. Okay. Go ahead.
All right, this is a painting of Gunnery Sergeant Gunny Carlos Hathcock, United States Marine. And he was one of the premier snipers of the Marine Corps in Vietnam. I painted this under his guidance. He's passed away now, but I painted this under his guidance in 1982 at Virginia Beach, Virginia. And the painting was shown at Camp Lejeune as a part of a ceremony honoring him. And the whole sniper school was there, plus other Marines at the Camp Lejeune. They had a big auditorium. I did one. This is one of five paintings that I painted depicting Hathcock in an action scene. Actually, as he called it, in his bubble, he would wait for days. This shows his spotter. Sometimes he worked with a spotter, and sometimes he worked solo, but. He was a very fine marksman, and he used the Winchester rifle, black. And this is actually, I believe, one of the more better representations of him that I've seen. I've seen other people that have tried to copy my painting, and they don't portray even the rifle the right color. The spider and the web here in the right-hand corner has symbolic meaning, that is this Hathcock being the spider and the enemy being the fly in the web. We have the bamboo viper in the bottom, and we have black ants on the move down in the lower left. This is sort of a very color scheme, a very dark color scheme. I have white palette and I have a dark palette. This is my dark palette, more of the Dutch school, showing the light, very maybe the very
early morning effects of a light starting on the horizon is back with them. Hathcock was a unique person, came from Arkansas. He was basically a hunter when he was a squirrel hunter when he was a kid. He developed an unusual, uncanny ability to snipe in the Marine Corps. And the sniper had had a bad reputation in history, but as you know, Hathcock saved a lot of American lives, a lot of Marines' lives by sniping other enemy snipers that would kill American soldiers. So he was so effective, as a matter of fact, that the enemy had a $10,000 bounty on his head, and he used to leave a feather, a little white feather, on either his victim's body or in the proximity of the area, and that was symbolic of who he was, and he was called White Feather.
Okay,
what about this one?
Okay, this painting here is titled Somebody's Got to Do It. It shows Nick Dragon from Hazel Park, Michigan, and Greg Hall from Oklahoma doing the worst detail you could have in Vietnam, and that was burning human waste. And what you would see here would be a trap door in an outhouse to the left there, and the soldiers, if they were put on this detail, it was the most the worst detail you could have in base camp. It was worse, much worse than being on KP, because what you had to do, you had to take the pan out of the outhouse, you had to add diesel fuel and aviation fuel and light it and stir it with a stick, and this black smoke was pungent, and it would get in everybody's clothing, and the whole base camp would smell from this human waste.
Did you ever have the pleasure?
I had some experience with that, but not as much as some other people did.
It was officially known as shit burning.
That's right. That was the correct vernacular.
I did it once, just so I could say I had done it.
I preferred to be out in the jungle, and we only came back once every 45 days, so those base camp warriors were more or less used for this purpose. Later, I became a base camp warrior, but I was behind the drafting table, and all I had to do was basically pull guard duty on the perimeter at night, or be the brigade track driver and go on convoy detail. But I have a very good resemblance of Nick Dragon, and you see a C-130 taking off from Dao Tang there. And here is a sergeant, a platoon sergeant, lecturing some new recruits, some new guys that just came in. And of course, the M16 and the web gear is to the right. And Greg Hall is not very happy about holding the jerry can there with the more fuel for Nick. But Nick always said that he waited for the wind to be in the right direction, that is, in the direction of the officer's quarters, before he lit the fire.
Okay, there's this other painting.
I believe this to be one of my better paintings. It's called Tiger One Ambush, and it was it portrays a jungle scene at night with an American ambush patrol hidden in a crater. Because the enemy is attacking in a massive attack formation, as you see them just vaguely running through the trees in the background with the flashes and the 50 caliber tracers going through the jungle and the vines and the density of the jungle, and only a very few highlights on the helmets, and it really portrays the horrific scary situation and the feeling of the jungle that I fortunately was not in a life and death situation this bad, but many of these fellows did survive that night because they were able to plan among themselves that night that they would only shoot with any enemy that came right to the edge of the crater. And then after that, they lobbed a grenade so that they would not survive for sure. And so the next morning, after over 450 body count were counted to the right in the perimeter where the battle took place, they counted over 35 bodies in front of their position. And of course, there was an innumerable enemy that was dragged back, dead and dying.
Okay, the other painting you wanted to look at was the 12th of Back.
12th of Back, yeah.
Okay.
This is a painting that was commissioned me by the 12th of Back. They were a medical unit, surgical unit, that was set up in Cochi, Vietnam in 1966. The doctors were drafted, the nurses had volunteered. The actual painting portrays actual surgeons and nurses and tech specialists that were located with the 12th of Vac. They treated over 37,000 patients between 1966 and 1970. This painting actually shows a corpsman, as they call them, in helmet and flak jacket, standing at the head of the operating table, which was protocol because of rocket and mortar attack. The time is a little after 3 o'clock in the morning. I have different oxygen bottles, and the anesthesiologist is Captain Campbell, and the surgeon on the right is Dr. Beard, and the nurse in the foreground is Ann Cunningham, and the nurse to the left is Beth Park, who was a young nurse who set up the 12th of Back herself in 1966 at PG. Everything here is pretty well researched out. Soldier is being operated on the operating table. Evidently, people I painted this for like this painting because they claim I captured the colors and the mood of the Quonset, where there were little areas, 8x10, where there were all these people operating, sometimes 12 operations taking place in one Quonset. And the painting is going to be permanently hung at the Fort Sam Houston Medical Corps Museum at San Antonio, Texas, after this show.
Now, did you do the frame?
No.
Or did you have someone do the frame?
The frame was made by Mike Cheney, who's in charge of cabinet making and carpentry at North Central Kansas Vocational School in Beloit, Kansas. It was a custom-made frame. It was commissioned by the 12th of Back. It has all their symbols, their slogan to conserve fighting strength. It has the medical symbols and Cochi 25th Division, and skilled and resolute, and 12th of Back Hospital. And SMDL stands for semi-mobile. Can't remember the rest. That's terrible.
Okay, well,
maybe one more.
Oh, okay,
here.
Sure.
Okay, sure.
One more would be Chaplain Tobin giving communion. This is one of the most popular paintings with veterans. This is Chaplain Jim Tobin, who was a priest with the 3rd Brigade, 25th Division, and he's giving communion out at a logger site, which we call the Circle of Tracks, a logger site. It shows a sunset, and here the Lieutenant Colonel Ob Norris is on the radio to the right, and these are actual portraits of soldiers that I knew in Vietnam. This is a portrait of Tom Bernardi, our medic, who was killed at birth. There's also David Ditch and Bill James, who were later killed. So you can see the vesicular and his combat boots under the vesicular, and it's a very good likeness of Chaplain Tobin. He's still active at our reunions. After the war, or close to the end of the war, he retired from the priesthood and married a widow of a Vietnam veteran that was killed, and they had a daughter who's in the United States Air Force as a pilot.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your interview.
Thank